if I could have your attention for a moment. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. Thank you for giving your attention and a great welcome to our graduation ceremony in this wonderfully refurbished conference suite at the City Hall in Bristol. And our thanks and gratitude to Bristol City Council for the support for this programme, which helped us be here today. So it's a great pleasure for me to kind of stand here and open this graduation ceremony. It's the fourth in our programme here, which started off as a purely Bristol programme and now has expanded into a Bristol and West of England programme. And I will say a bit more about that later. But over these 4 years, we have supported close to 80 social entrepreneurs, students and aspiring entrepreneurs in the city and around. And they are doing good work. They have joined the social economy here, which is kind of vibrant in the city, but themselves have created now 150 jobs and 400 volunteering opportunities, and they're turning over well over £1 million every year. So we are kind of contributing with our work, not just to the kind of wealth and well-being of communities, but actually also creating jobs and supporting the economy in the city and around in the kind of area around Bristol. So it's a great pleasure to kind of have you here, where we are kind of celebrating 21 students who are finishing the programme at this point, and you're going to hear from them in a moment, and I'm going to keep you too long about this. So, now I was supposed to hand over to the Chief Operating Officer of Dartington Trust to say why Dartington Trust is supporting this programme. Unfortunately, her train got cancelled. I think she'll be here with us in about half an hour. So, I'm just going to say a few things of what she would have said. And the key thing for Dartington Trust is that we have a very strong historical connection with social enterprise and particularly with School for Social Entrepreneurs, because the founder of School for Social Entrepreneurs actually grew up in Dartington, went to school there, and got a lot of his education and forming from the aims and visions of the founders of the Dartington Trust. So Michael Young, later Lord Young of Dartington, went to London and, amongst many other things, set up School for Social Entrepreneurs. And we were really lucky that in 2009, as part of a sort of regional expansion of the school and the creation of a social franchise network, we were able to have a school back in Dartington, which now serves the southwest from Bristol all the way down to Plymouth. So with that, Dartington is very kind of pleased to support the school and is very much part of the strategy of Dartington Trust to be a place of social innovation, social enterprise, and the kind of, I suppose, a place for social justice, for inclusion, for accessibility, and the kind of good growth and good economy that I think we are all in this place here now looking for. And it's with great pleasure that I'm sort of looking at the first of our students to come up here and kind of present their project to you. We will be running through all the students, and if you have in your bag your graduation booklet, they're in the order of the booklet, so if you want to make some notes to kind of see somebody afterwards, because we will have an exhibition and refreshments. If you want to offer them support or kind of just encouragement, if you look at the handbook, it kind of follows the same order. Okay, with that, I think you're the first, Matt.
Yes.
I'll make space for you and welcome you onto the stage.
Hello, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Cool. Okay, so my name's Matt and my social enterprise is called Exceptional Individuals. We're an employment agency for people with dyslexia. We also support people with Asperger's, autism, ADHD as well. But today I'm going to focus on dyslexia, and the reason why is I myself am dyslexic. This is a young me. I was diagnosed around this age, but at the time I never really understood what it meant or how it affected me. I kind of shied away from it a bit. I was a bit embarrassed. And as a result, through my school years, I kind of got C's, D's and E's and really struggled. Somehow though, I managed to get into university, and it was there where I started to learn more about dyslexia, that it wasn't a bad thing, and it's just kind of a different way of learning, a different way of thinking. And something I never thought was possible at the time, as I got more support available, I actually achieved a first in my degree. Because I had the support, because I knew more about dyslexia, I found out people like Pablo Picasso, Albert Einstein, John Lennon all have dyslexia and they've achieved amazing things. The problem started for me when I actually left university. The support wasn't there anymore, and I was trying to get into work, but because of aptitude tests, psychometric tests, long application forms, the odd misspelt spelling, I really struggled to get into employment. And I wasn't the only one. Currently in the UK, 1 in 10 people are dyslexic, so it's around 6 million people, but 4 in 10 unemployed are dyslexic, so there's a huge pool of missed talent, and employers just don't have processes in place, and there was no support available. So this kind of inspired me to start Exceptional Individuals to support these people. This is Jasmine. Jasmine applied for over 50 jobs and she was getting nowhere. She came to us, we helped her with her CV, her application form, and then we contacted one of our partner employers, which is Ryman, and got her into work. And she's doing incredible things there now. Hopefully soon she's in line for a promotion. And through SSE support, we've also helped 46 other people into work in the past year. But we've had nearly 5,000 CVs in the past 6 months. So we're looking for more and more employers to get on board and give our guys opportunities. So if you know of anyone that may be able to provide our exceptional candidates with opportunities, please let me know. My stand's over there, and it's going to be an excellent day today with all these other guys as well. So thank you for listening.
Hi. Lucy can't be with us, and as a team, we're all missing her, so I'm going to be her mouthpiece for the next 3 minutes. Mary Brown, age 73, adds the final flower to her window display. She puts on her coat, steps out into a cold winter's night, and in the opposite house, a rock band's playing. Next door, there's a huge giraffe in the window. And as she goes back towards her house, a young child says, "What's with the flowers?" And she explains that earlier on that year, her husband passed away. Making those flowers got her through Christmas. This is Window Wonderland. We live closer together than ever before, but we're becoming more and more isolated. Over 7.5 million people live alone in Britain, and this is rising. Lucy, the founder of Window Wonderland, has mobility problems herself. She knows how it feels to be stuck indoors. A few years ago, she was taking one of her walks late at night, and she found that if she could see into the windows of other people, it just took away that pain just for a minute, just gave her something else to think about. Now, we know that creativity and connecting with other humans enhances well-being. Window Wonderland's events bring everyone together. It's healthy, it gets you outdoors, and it promotes pride within communities. Anyone who sees it loves it and then shares it. Now Lucy knows this, as through word of mouth alone, that went from 1 to 7 happening nationally. And now there are 20 different organisations that have come forward wanting to do their own, including one in Australia. Window Wonderland is an event in a box. It can be opened in any street, in any country. And Lucy says that the support from SSE has been invaluable in helping her develop her project. On her behalf, I'd like to thank them, her fellows, for their love, advice and friendship over the year. Now, do they need money? Window Wonderland are open to partnerships, sponsors, and anyone who's interested to join them. They're a fantastic initiative to be a part of, so please contact them if you're interested.
Following on in a creative vein, Bristol's creative sector is one of the UK's key growth areas, yet we're still seeing young people struggling to get into the field and a lack of diversity across the sector's workforce. My name's Kamina, and a key focus of my work is to set up creative communities with and for young people. I set up Rising Arts Agency a year ago with my co-director, 23-year-old Laura Gabe. Rising is a social enterprise that has been co-created with young people for those 16 to 25-year-old filmmakers, visual artists, illustrators, and many more who strive for a career in the creative sector, particularly those who are currently underrepresented. Rising is an incubator for young talent. We offer creative leadership training, platforms to showcase work, and mentoring support. Our mentoring programme is at Rising's heart. We've already been endorsed by over 50 creative sector industry professionals who have signed up to mentor a young person, helping to increase their confidence and self-esteem. As one young mentee said, Rising's mentoring programme picked me up at exactly the right moment. It's amazing how much direction and momentum I've generated through that one-to-one support. Support from SSE has helped us with getting this mentoring programme off the ground and has also given the opportunity for young people who couldn't afford travel to get into town or needed assistance to come and be involved in the programme. We also have really great partnerships with the city's creative sector and youth organisations. So there are two key challenges that we're trying to address. Firstly, the skills gap. 69% of businesses say that young people leaving full-time education don't have the skills needed to enter into the workplace. 30% of graduates are leaving university with no chance for a job, and often many years on have still not found employment. The second issue is diversity. 16% of Bristol's population is from the BAME community. Yet within the creative sector, there's still a really low representation of this community in the workforce. In our first year, in our mentoring matches, we've supported 50% of the young people from the BAME community to be matched with a mentor. So, in our first pilot year, what impact have we had? We've supported 6 young people into the workplace. We've created 4 new artist commissions. We've had 3 creative enterprises that we've supported and 16 successful mentoring matches. But in order to build on this success, we need investment. £300 will support a young person to create new work or gain specific skills. £3,000 would allow us to create a bespoke 6-month mentoring programme for 6 young people. So, just to end with a final quote from another young mentee, it's amazing how much of an effect someone believing in you can have on your motivation and resilience. With my mentor's breadth of experience perfectly suited to my desired career path, I've gained invaluable insight that I can't imagine ever being able to access elsewhere. Thank you.
My name is Mia Demi. I'm a chartered mechanical engineer and a woman of faith who loves to play. I remember when I was 10 years old and my uncle took me to the playground. He'd push me on the swings, the excitement and fear that would shoot through my bones as I flew into the sky. I'm a children's worker and youth worker who loves to play. And yet I was shocked when I found out in 2012 that a community in Tanzania required me, a mechanical engineer, not to build a well, but to build a playground. I was shocked until I arrived in the arid land that was supposed to be their play area. The children in SLA community, which is in Tanzania, were full of life, resourceful, but at playtime had nothing more but slender trees and broken ground to feast their imagination on. I agree with the strong evidence that links playing with creativity, it links playing with developing social skills, and it's also links playing with developing early childhood development. So that's why I decided I can think more, what can engineers can do? And that's when my social enterprise Dream Networks is birthed. In response to a need, a global need. Dream Networks CIC collaborates with businesses, schools, and businesses to create sustainable playgrounds in disadvantaged communities. We work with the children themselves, the end user. Collaboratively, we design play areas that can change their minds, change their world, and change their perspective. So we start in the beginning with the disadvantaged communities, understanding what their needs are, what materials they have in their environment. The next step is working with children in the community and primary school children in the UK and in Tanzania and secondary school children also to collaboratively design the play areas. How do we do this? We use digital tools. We harness the power of technology. By harnessing the power of technology and also working with business volunteers, we're able to apply science, technology, engineering and mathematics to take their creative designs into feasible solutions. The next stage is actually building. So we, of course, our play areas are built in 2015, one of our play areas was built in Bristol. So Bristol Wild Place has a playground that is actually being built by our children and by our businesses. Now, this year, with the help of SSC, we're building a playground for 1,500 children in Tanzania, with 6 to 16-year-old children play. Our play area is very creative, so you can see part of it on my stand. So you've got a sensory play ship for children with special educational needs. We've got a gymnastics area, and we also have a dance stage, numerous things, and that's what we're going to design. Right now, I would say, last year, one of our children, a young boy, said to me, okay, what have I noticed from this program? I realized engineering can be so cool. At a time where everyone thinks engineering is difficult and there's a strong shortage of engineers, it's a perfect time to get involved in a program that enables people to design playgrounds that can be sustainably built, community tailored, supported by businesses, and have a creative player for all. So what I need now is for more businesses with resources, their mindsets and their value times to come and join us. We've Dream Networks, Creative Playgrounds, it's Charles Bay. So come and join us. Come and join the stand. Thank you.
Oh, did I come the wrong way?
Huh? Hey. Right. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Michelle Meredith. I'm a community champion, and I've been involved in the community for the last 10 years, mainly in my spare time and on a volunteer basis. And it's been a long road, and sometimes it's been rocky, other times it's been pleasant, but I must admit that this year, through SSE, I've really enjoyed it, and I'd like to thank them for giving me the opportunity. And my personal development has come on leaps and bounds. Bristol, we read, is a diverse city. Anytime you open a newspaper, there's plenty of opportunities for all. But just imagine facing discrimination in all aspects of your life, whether it's employment, health, education, and housing, all because of your race, colour, or religion. Today, unemployment within the diverse communities is a serious problem. All these opportunities we read about just out of reach for the majority of the people I represent. And underrepresentation amongst the various diverse communities is the reason why I started Connecting Our Communities, which is the name of my business. I live in Bristol, my business is based in Bristol, it's in the inner city areas. And what I'm going to be looking to do is provide professional services to help my clients better engage with diverse communities and their stakeholders. But most importantly, I'm also going to be connecting these diverse communities to share their opinions and create channels of influence because together they can take action. The services that I'm going to be offering are community consultation and field research, market research, event services, and corporate outreach services to help businesses meet their corporate social responsibility needs. And if you're an employer, then you're thinking, well, why should we come to me? I've had 10 years of experience, and that 10 years was gained through the African and Caribbean Chamber of Commerce. And through that, we had a youth chamber, and there's one young man in the room who left us and decided to set up his own social enterprise. And he sat at the back there, his name is Poku. And his business is now called Babasa. And I've been a volunteer with them for the last 5 years. And I then got involved with the Stapleton Road Traders. If any of you live in Bristol, you know that Stapleton Road has got about 150 different shops. It's a very diverse community. And I was a facilitator to get the association set up. And through the traders, they're connected together and they have had action taken. And then now, most recently, I'm working with another social enterprise called CC Bed, and they're all based in the inner centre of Bristol. The reason why any employer should consider getting in touch with is that my USP is that I can step into the various diverse communities and I'm accepted by them all because I'm respected and they see me as impartial and I'm well connected to the communities. So my call to action to you today is I want all of you to help me reach the employers to discuss how they can help me to help our diverse communities. Because after all, business and society do not exist in isolation of one another. Thank you for listening.
Hi, everyone. My name's Annalie, and I'm the founder of Literarti. And we use art to connect communities around sustainability issues. So over the last year in 2016, we've been very fortunate to engage with more than 2,000 individuals, children, young people, parents, teachers, educators, and just residents daily, adults like you and I. We've done workshops around waste materials, connecting with materials. We've spoken and had conversations about environmental ethics. We've connected people to their local areas with our litter campaigns. And we've also encouraged creative activism through our events and exhibitions. We inspired others through talks and our consultations. And we entertained others at festivals. Of this group of people, around 400 of those individuals do suffer neglect socially on a daily basis. And a lot of our work do take us into areas of neglect as well. And this is kind of issues that I had to sit with again this year and constantly refining why, you know, you are drawn to something and do something. And this, the thing about tackling inequality, in order to tackle climate change, we need to tackle inequality. And then it starts making me question, with all this social stuff that's going on in the world at the moment, how can we even focus on climate change when all these other things are so much more immediate? The thing is, the way I see it, this rubbish and whatever you see, all this environmental stuff, this is just the symptoms of an illness that's everywhere. If you live in Clifton, if you live in Eastville, wherever you are, we all suffer that illness. The problem is where the cancer goes and sit and grow is in the deprived areas. And by only recognizing each other and realizing it's not someone else's problem, that's actually where the empowerment lies. And it's the permission that we need. There's something about connecting to land, and I think that's also an issue. How do I take responsibility for something if I'm not connected to it, if I don't own it? And how do you generate that pride? So what we seek to do is to create more spaces where conversations can take place around the creative activities that we provide. We want to plant seeds to inspire change through engagement, which empowers, uplifts, and provokes. Giving people permission to take action, that is what sets us free. Thank you.
Didn't mean that. It's with great pleasure that I'm here to represent Laura Cox. Laura got pregnant 9 months ago, and for 9 months she's been really nervous about having a baby on this stage, right here, right now. So she decided to have it a week earlier. Hence, she's not here, and she sends her apologies and love to you all. The Sad Ghost Club is a club for anyone who's ever felt sad or lost. It's the club for those who don't feel like they're part of any other club. It's run by Laura and her business partner, Lees, who love creating comics and zines to highlight the issues that a lot of ghosties go through. Hands up if you've ever been a teenager. Hands up if you've ever parented a teenager. Hands up if you're still currently parenting a teenager. Teenagers and young people, from my perspective, and I know that Laura shares this, go through a huge amount of mental health concerns, issues, stresses and strains. And none more so than in 2016, where I suppose the literacy around mental health and awareness of issues has never been greater. What Laura's chosen to do is address her own social anxiety through her business. She told me a story in one of our supervision sessions about her social anxiety. She went down to Exeter University to do a workshop with a bunch of students, and the closer she got to the venue, the more stress she began to feel. After the workshop, her and her partner were mobbed by over 100 students who were so excited to meet them, it was almost like a fan club situation. And she coped with it and she managed it and she came back and reflected on it. She's made as many program days as she can, and her trajectory through the program has been to build her confidence and build her self-awareness of her own issues. One of the things that they really focus on, there are a two-girl band really working out of central Bristol, focusing on a global network of connected young people. A small creative project making comic books, apparel and merchandise to spread positive awareness of mental health. They work with mental health charities and are currently working on collaborating with artists to send a bigger message of mental health awareness. They're at thesadghostclub.com, and if there's one thing I'd like you to do by the end of today is go on their website or take your children to their website, and my kids have been on it and think it's absolutely fantastic. To finish off, and it's their strapline really, if you've ever been sad, then you're already a member. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. My name's Hannah Hughes and I'm the founder and leader of Unit C1 Thrivability Hub. We're a solution-based space that can realise thrivability. We do that by accessing good food, nutritional support, sustainable infrastructure and training, and networking to strengthen our communities and better our self-care. The space hosts five key holders who hold their enterprises there and have varying roles within the organisation, supporting the members who come for personal and enterprise support, and together we host inclusive community workshops in food and health sovereignty. The Thrivability Hub is based in Glastonbury. It's a small rural town. It's got a history of poverty and low incomes, as it has been a place where many pilgrims have travelled on a long journey of self, personal and spiritual development and change, often with many mental health issues as well, which has put much strain on the community, its resources and its local economy. I found myself in Glastonbury as one of those people, finding it difficult to access support to better my life and move forwards. So I was driven to make a space with the resources that I needed, and inspired by the knowledge of how different the journey can be with support and access to the things that you need. So I made Unit C1 Thrivability Hub as a space that can do those things with a faith and a knowing that it really can make a difference. It really can bring people together and take them down those barriers and support people. What if every town, every community had a place where good nutrition, mutual support, health, access to resources and enterprises were supported, enabled? People and the communities could thrive. The health of the community, we'd begin to start resourcing off-grid options so that everyone could be more independent and interdependent as well. I ask anyone who believes that this could be something that could change their community or has faith with me that my project can change my community too. I see its effects. Come and talk to me. Check out my details in the booklet, or give me a shout and stop by for a cup of tea and see what we do. Thanks very much.
Hello, everybody. So, an 8-year-old girl is sitting on a fence, watching a herd of horses playing in a field. She's mesmerised by the way they're interacting. Who's the leader? Who's the follower? Who's in charge? Is it the bravest, the boldest? That little girl was me. Okay, a few years ago now. But I'm still just as passionate about ponies and horses today as I was back then. I've got two teenagers myself, and I've been so fortunate that I've been able to bring my two passions in life together, children and horses, so Malvern Hills Pony Centre was born. In Worcestershire alone, the amount of children that are in care has risen by over 22% in 5 years. It's risen from 521 to 651. We support these young people at Malvern Hills Pony Centre by giving them experiences that facilitate positive youth development. We teach them leadership skills and how to interact with a pony. This exposes them to positive experience and the opportunity to refine key life skills, which are transferable through childhood to adulthood. To train a pony successfully, they learn social and communicational skills and important key life practices, which is respect for themselves, respect for others, and responsibility for all they do. We also like to help children that are reluctant to engage with professionals. This can be down to mistrust, apprehension, or just struggle with professional bodies. We can offer a useful alternative to conventional learning routes. Horses can be the crucial motivation that children need to be switched back onto education. And this allows our instructors to work sensitively and intensively with these young people, building on their strengths. Children with special educational needs, all our afternoons take place in a relaxed, quiet environment, which helps with confidence. It also gives the children, it lowers stress levels, and it makes them more well-rounded and balanced. Our courses normally take over a 6-week period. We do one afternoon a week, and the children all complete a written journal. And this is given to them as photographic evidence for them to take home with them of what they've achieved. I decided not to be a conventional riding instructor. I wanted to use the skills I've learned and the horses I've trained to help the children that need it the most. The children that really get the most out of learning confidence, empathy, and understanding. Thanks to SSE, we've managed to take 3 lots of children with different educational needs through the programme, and the results that we've had has been fantastic. My want would be help with more funding if possible, so we can train more ponies, more instructors, to therefore help more children. Thank you.
Afternoon. My name is Beck, and I run something which I've confusingly called the Tortworth Forest Centre. 2 years ago, I was in the slightly unexpected position of being offered a 20-acre arboretum to manage. This is an arboretum in South Gloucestershire. It is the most incredible place. It was planted in the 1850s by the local Earl. It hosts over 300 exotic and champion and veteran trees and a host of biodiversity and wildlife. It really is amazing. Unfortunately, it was stopped in its management about 8 years ago. They stopped looking after it, and some of the trees have fallen down, and it's basically decaying. So, of course, with my zero knowledge whatsoever of woodland management, I said, yes, of course I will look after your woodland for you. I did this because I've been very fortunate in my life to really, really understand the healing power that nature can have when people face challenges. Nature and being in nature, working in nature, is good for your mental and physical health, your emotional well-being, and it has the effect of creating more resilient and happier people, regardless of their background. To this end, we work with people who suffer from anything to do with social isolation, so addiction or mental health challenges. primarily people from Bristol, but also from the local area of the Woodland. Anybody who wants to volunteer can come and volunteer. Through our volunteering and our events and our conservation work and our pioneering women's project, we run a women's project which works with women in recovery from addiction, we've made some very significant changes, not just to the woodland, but to people's lives. So we're not only bringing this woodland back to health and saving it for future generations, but also working on the health and well-being of the people who come with us and volunteer and work on it. Our volunteers tell us they feel more self-confidence. They find themselves more resilient to the challenges that they face in their lives, and their self-worth is very obviously increased the longer they spend with us. And this is all because they're there watching the woodland improve as a result of the work that they're doing. One of our volunteers, that's in fact him, told us at the beginning that he hadn't actually left his house for 3 years apart from to go and get milk from the shop. I didn't really believe this, how was that possible? But it's true, he never left his house. After just over a year with us, he's now leading other groups of volunteers, and he's very vocal and he's very involved in the project, and yeah, the transformation that he has gone through has been inspirational. Thanks to SSE and the support and the grant and the cohort that we've been working with, I've been able to buy a laptop where you can see our film a little bit later on if you wish. We've leveraged over £11,000 worth of advertising through Clear Channel, as well as getting lots of grant money in. And I've also embarrassed him, I found one of my key volunteers and made him a director. So now I have support when I'm running this organisation. My last thank you before I run out of time has to be to Deanna, my SSE mentor, who's been there through thick and thin and turned someone who's very excited about trees and people into someone who actually puts a strategy together, brings in money and makes it all happen in a sort of fairly coherent way. So thank you very much to my lovely mentor, and that's it from me. Thank you very much.
And it's called All Right Mate. I'm the founder of All Right Mate. I'm a graduate of SSE, and as of last week, I'm also a very proud father. Thank you very much. And Laura, who couldn't make it today, was actually in the next room to my wife last Tuesday, so pretty special. Thank you all very much for being here today. We believe at All Right Mate that sport doesn't build character, it reveals it. And on that note, I used to coach a young man called Stephen. And Stephen used to come into a sports session with me 3 times a week, and he was just brilliant. And he had attributes that would shine in a sports hall. He'd thrive, and he'd do that through sport. And he'd chat with coaches, and he'd engage, and all round just a great person to be around. And it wasn't until shortly after I saw Stephen in a very different context. I saw him trying to talk to adults in a more professional setting. Stephen was a very different person. He just didn't have the confidence. He wasn't able to express himself, and he wasn't able to reveal that character. You see, that's the thing, isn't it, with sport? You know, sport, we kind of coach, we use drills and skill development, and we do it over a long period of time, so we're actually more confident the more we do of it. Whereas take something like public speaking, 49% of us have a real fear of getting up like this and speaking in front of other people. In fact, I'd be fascinated to know who has ever had a fear of public speaking here in the room today, of standing up and talking in front of others. It's a really scary thing, isn't it? And so we thought, well, actually, sport can engage, sport does engage. We believe in the power of it as a tool to engage disengaged young people from disadvantaged backgrounds. But what more can we do? And that's when we started wrapping around employability and enterprise skills. That's when we started working on soft skills with young people. And so we used targeted personal development programs to help boost confidence of young people from disadvantaged backgrounds so that they can actually convey and reveal their true character in a professional setting as well as a sports setting. How do we fund this? Well, we fund this by taking the same tools and applying them to a professional setting. So we run coaching, consultancy, and training for the corporate sector, the charitable third sector, and also at the moment, the educational sector. My big call to action today, and what I'd like to invite you to do, is I would really enjoy talking more about anybody that you know in any of those three sectors who values learning development, who values personalised learning programmes that can help to build the confidence of their people. My name's James Cullen. I run OrateMate, and you can get me at hello@oratemate.com. I don't know whether that's in the programme. It is in the programme, fantastic. I'm sorry, I've got a bit of baby brain. I don't even have a business card on me at the moment. So thank you all very much. I'm going to get a hot meal and a long sleep, and I'll see you all again soon. All right, cheers.
Okay, this is me in me form. My name's Pete Davis. I'm the learning manager for the SSE Lloyds Bank Startup Programme for Bristol and the wider environment. It's been a real pleasure to be here, not just today, but for the past 12 months. It's been a real journey for me. I've been a teacher, I've been a service leader, I've been a panel chair, I've been this, I've been that, but I haven't really facilitated an adult learning programme like this one. It's been a real experience. So thank you for the opportunity. I'm still in. I'm doing another year. I can see a few of you out there that have started on the next journey with me, and we're going to go in the same direction. I'd just like to thank the group as well. It's been a phenomenal ride, really. I don't think we quite expected to be where we all are 12 months after we set off. Lots of different directions, lots of different angles, but basically coming in at the same point, at the same time, right here and now. So thank you for supporting me, supporting you. It's been a riot. So I had one thing to do today, and that was to organise something called the Peer of the Year. And the Peer of the Year is where the cohort, they get to vote for someone else in the group that's been supportive, collaborative, generous, inclusive, etc., etc. And in September when we met, they gave me that vote. This morning when me and Sam said, who is it? Neither of us knew. So we, unlike Brexit, these guys got to vote again. Okay, so first of all, they've had to go through that process again. This time I do have an outstanding candidate to be able to present a gift to. But interestingly, we gave them 20 people to vote from. And the standout thing for me is not just the person who's been voted in, but 11 people got at least one vote. And that shows me that the strength of this group is within the group and the relationships between it. So, between you all. So there is someone who has to come up and present, I think it's a gift, yeah? To Mr. Dave Martin, everybody. Thank you very much.
And I run the Generation 2050 project. It's a social enterprise which inspires a kinder world through the power of storytelling. The idea for Generation 2050 came around when I was teaching in South Korea. I wanted to teach my students about animals and the environment, but I couldn't find any online resources that I thought delivered anything of educational value. I thought it was just loosely related to the topics. So I created my own materials. I came up with my own solution, and I produced little stories for the children in my school. I realised that books had played a pivotal role in my childhood in shaping my mind, and I wanted to inspire the next generation to be responsible world citizens who would take responsibility for other people, animals and the environment. Nelson Mandela once said, "Education is the most powerful weapon we have to change the world," and I too believe that education is a powerful tool for positive social change. I think that stories bring ideas to life and allow readers to step inside the lives of other people, other animals, other than themselves, and develop a capacity for empathy and understanding. At the end of 2014, I raised some funds from selling some old clothes and I published my first book. To date, I have published 8 books on topics from bee population decline to plastic pollution to using unicorns as a metaphor for captive wild animals. Since the programme began, I've published a further 5 books. I've created online teaching resources for teachers to access in schools, and I've run workshops in schools on various topics on animals and the environment. I've also produced 2 textbooks on animal behaviour and animal welfare, and I think there's a gap in the market for this because they continue to sell steadily throughout the year, and I didn't even launch them, I just put them on sale. So I think that's proven that there is a market for it. Over the summer, I ran my most ambitious campaign to date, and I had a crowdfunder to raise £1,000 to send 1,000 copies of my new book to some charities in India. And they include animal rescue organisations, and there was also a charity to help educate children living on a rubbish dump. This campaign involved a free event in my local town where children could learn about animals and the environment through art. There was a fantastic turnout, and I raised £446 on the day towards the campaign. In the end, I raised £1,500 and I sent 1,100 books to 7 different locations in India. The charities were all thrilled and felt that their books would enhance their education programmes. So where next for Generation 2050? I'd like to run more workshops, and I'd like to move into creative writing workshops. And also I'd like to continue to work with charities to enhance their messaging. My next book will be with a cat rescue charity in Spain to encourage people not to dump cats, basically, and get their pets neutered, and we'll be giving those out to free to schools in Spain. That's it, thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Chloe from No More Taboo. So let's talk periods. So 1 in 7 women in this room are on their period right now. I'm guessing most of us don't really want to talk about it. But sometimes periods actually hold us back. Take 13-year-old Maria in rural Bolivia, where all this started for me. Due to a cultural taboo, she's not allowed to touch water while she's on her period, which means she can't wash for up to a week. How do you think that makes her feel? Or what about Charlotte? She's a sofa surfer right here in Bristol who can't afford to buy pads and is having to use toilet paper. We want to empower all women everywhere to embrace their period. Bear with me on the embrace. So we sell reusable, sustainable sanitary products, and we use the profits to support women and girls like Maria and Charlotte to have healthier and happier periods. But why reusable products? Well, in a woman's lifetime, she'll use over 11,000 disposable sanitary products, which creates 150 kilos of waste and costs her over £3,500. One pack of disposable sanitary towels has the equivalent to 4 plastic carrier bags, which we banned last year. So we've been told from an early age that we have 2 options, pads or tampons. No More Taboo are working to educate through public advocacy and working in secondary schools that there is a choice, and these are often more modern, innovative and comfortable solutions, including menstrual cups and washable pads. We understand that it's a big change for women to make, so we want to help them make that change by offering a monthly hug on your period. A subscription service that helps women to find the right reusable product that works for them, see how they're impacting on the lives of Maria or Charlotte, and also gives them a gift, like chocolate, to say, hey, you know what, your period's not all that bad. We want to become financially sustainable within the next 5 years so that all of our projects are funded through sales of our products. If we achieve this goal, we'll have worked with over 9,000 UK school children, have 10 UK and 2 international partners working with the women living in poverty. School for Social Enterprise has helped us get one step closer to that goal. Over the last year, we've worked with over 138 school children, and we're about to pilot our first homelessness project tackling period poverty here in Bristol, involving 10 organisations in the city. We've been able to reach new supporters and raise over £7,000 in a crowdfunding campaign. We're currently looking for support to help launch our subscription-based model, whether that's in the form of funding or helping us to reach new markets, especially around working mums. Any advice would be greatly appreciated. So come and chat periods with me over at the stall after the presentations. Thank you.
I travelled here from Birmingham, and at no point did I feel scared or fearful for my life. At no point have I felt alone or vulnerable. At no point have I felt that there was the very real chance that I may not make it home. But imagine if that was how you felt any time you stepped outside of your own neighbourhood, a prisoner defined by your postcode. In Birmingham, where I'm from, this is the very depressing and very real actuality for many young people, victims of neglected and impoverished communities with no aspirations, no self-esteem, no hope. In 2011, I was commissioned by the Birmingham City Council to write and produce a short film highlighting the issues of knife crime to be used alongside an educational resource in youth offending institutions across the city. It was while doing this that I witnessed firsthand how the collaborative and creative nature of film, drama and creativity breaks down barriers, educates and inspires. Young people from different areas of Birmingham came together and worked towards a common goal, forging relationships, developing trusts and seeing the possibilities of their own unfulfilled potential. They saw that the world could be explored and that there was support for them. From then on, I began working towards producing my own projects, using my own creative talents and those of the network I had around me to continue to develop young people. Since incorporating in 2015, Viewfinder has completed numerous projects using drama, theatre, film and photography, enabling young people to explore relevant social and personal issues in a safe, creative and inspiring environment. The resources that we create are directed and shaped by the young people leading them, and so they directly relate to other young people engaging in them. We work nationwide alongside professional filmmakers, forensic psychologists and drama practitioners. We are flexible in terms of our budget and content, and we work to the needs of the young people we are there to develop. Our films have been viewed internationally, our theatre productions are always in front of a full house, and our community projects always bring people together. In short, the projects that Viewfinder produce are professional, they are relevant, they are engaging, of a high standard, and they work. Young people who have worked with us have gone on to higher education. They've gone on to set up their own business. They've gone into full-time employment, and all of this despite the disadvantages that they have faced. This year, we've been able to secure quite a bit of funding, which has helped us run various projects, and we've been able to keep them free for the young people and the organisations we work in. But we are determined to become sustainable and sell our services, our benefits, directly as well. We believe that inspiring and supporting young people, raising their aspirations and their self-esteem, and showing them a path to a better future is one of the most important legacies any of us can leave. And so if you like the sound of what we do, I ask you to think of your contacts in schools here in Bristol, academies and youth organisations of all kinds, and put us together. The world changes one mentality at a time. We are passionate about creating lasting positive change by educating and inspiring young people, and we hope that with the help of you and people like you, we can continue to change mentalities and contribute towards changing the world. Thank you.
My name is Neha Chaudhry and I am the founder and director of Walk to Be.
I started off as a product design engineer, and throughout my design studies, I wanted to create something that would actually make a difference in people's life, even if it's to a minimal level. I saw my granddad suffer from Parkinson's for 8 years, and I know it was hard. When given a chance in my final year of undergraduate, I researched into Parkinson's, and I found that the disease itself puts strain on the body, but it affects emotionally and socially to the people as well. So people gave up going out or socializing with people because it was affecting their dignity by carrying these medical-looking products. This is where Walk to Beat comes into being. Our first product is a walking stick designed for Parkinson patients. It helps them to overcome freezing problems. The idea is that when the person's walking, the stick senses the movement, and when they have a freezing episode, a pulse comes on that acts as a trigger and reminds them to start walking again. From the outside, it looks like a normal walking stick, but it's to provide them that confidence and independence when they're walking out and not looking something different to other people. Sadly, 127,000 people in the UK experience Parkinson's, and this number is set to rise by 16% in 2017. Currently, we're developing the product towards the finished finalized product, and we're also looking into partnering up with a software development company, which is to build services around these products. For example, while you're walking with the stick, you can actually track the walking pattern, and this would allow to track falls timely and avoid injuries, which in old age can be a bigger problem. Walk to Beat Special Walking Stick is set to be launched by spring 2017, but for this, we need your support. So Walk to Beat is for the people, by the people. If you know anyone who can benefit from the product or add value to it, please come and talk to me. And you can also have a go with the product at the end of my talk. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Chloe Meineck. I am a designer, inventor, and founder of Studio Meineck. Studio Meineck is a social design company. We specialize in designing with people rather than for people. We develop our own products, consult on research projects, and run workshops nationally and internationally. We collaborate with charities and academics to create beautiful products. So it all started back in 2011 when my loved one had dementia. I was struggling to have the same conversations we used to. I was struggling to find that connection. So I looked into how familiar music and tangible objects and memories could help us connect again. So I created the Music Memory Box. Like many people with dementia, she suffered from depression, she was confused, and she was anxious. What we found is through our years and years of working with different people with dementia, the families, hospitals, care homes, we found that the benefits of using Music Memory Box are that it reduces anxiety and confusion. It creates a better communication between loved ones and the family, and it builds a stronger sense of identity. In 2015, Music Memory Box was a finalist in the National Dementia Care Awards. It's still a prototype, and it was in the most innovative product categories. This is a real good thing for the company. From my years of working with people with dementia, we've been running workshops across the UK, directly in Bristol with the Bristol Dementia Wellbeing Service, in Japan and the US this year. Dementia is a worldwide problem, we all know, and products like this that are innovative, that use creativity, that use familiar music can really, really help families and loved ones. So currently we're scaling up. We're building a larger team. We're also developing a second product using similar technology, but this is for children in care and adopted children, connecting life story with objects and narrative. We need the final piece of our puzzle, which is some funding, to get to the stage where we can launch our Kickstarter campaign. We've got families that really, really want the product and really need the product now, but we're struggling with the funding. We need partners in healthcare across Bristol, so if you know of a care home or you know of a group of people that we can come and show our product to, please get in touch. Let's get Music Memory Box into the hands of people that really need it. Let's get people living with dementia reminiscing, recollecting, and reconnecting. Thanks.
Before I say anything else, I'd just like you to all stand up. Just 2 seconds. Shake yourself down. Yeah. Okay, that's enough. I just thought it was that point in the day. My name is Helen Lang, and I'm the founder and director of Innovation Box. Innovation Box builds digital skills in charities and social enterprises by drawing on the expertise and knowledge of specialists from the private sector. Ironically, I was that person that hated technology. I think it's fair to say, in fact, I was a bit of a Luddite. However, I struggled with a long period of undiagnosed illness and anxiety. I found it very difficult to leave the house, and really, using the online information was a lifeline for me. It was invaluable. However, it was also really difficult to find information, and I realised for people less savvy than me, it was a real challenge. What I realised was the fact that it's not that the charities aren't there, I knew where to look, it's just that these charities aren't comfortable with digital. For those that do try to find the support, often it's expensive and costly. The marketplace is dominated by very expensive consultancies most small to medium-sized charities really can't engage with. To give you, I suppose, a measure of the problem, the Charity Technology Trust did a piece of research, and the charity sector is investing less than 1% of its turnover per annum. It trails behind every other sector in the UK in this regard. CAT runs a fantastic charity that puts hospitals, cinemas into hospitals. It's for the chronically sick to give them a respite from their illness. She has repeatedly struggled to secure funding because she needs to demonstrate the impact of what she does. She needs a system that makes it very easy for her staff across the country to do that. She's been repeatedly let down by costly consultancies. She needs an organisation like Innovation Box. We've worked over the last year with the support of SSE and a team of tech specialists and my experience of 10 years in skill volunteering with the corporate sector to develop a programme that supports organisations. To date, we've already worked with 6 organisations to test the idea. We're in conversation at the moment with 3 global multinationals, and we're running a workshop series working with over 60 organisations with specialists in the sector, both from places like TNS, a national marketing agency, and specialists like change.org. Innovation Box matches skilled volunteers with charities over a period of 6 months to understand what their strategic needs are in terms of how they can use technology, but also most fundamentally to help them understand what they can do at the right cost and with the right people. We provide a level of expertise and knowledge most charities simply cannot afford to buy. However, we also do this to work with our partner companies to develop their staff. We do this to ensure that they're taking skills back into the workplace, and it also helps improve their retention. We charge our corporates to do this, and this means that we can then ensure that we're reaching more charities with that money. Innovation Box is the only organisation to provide managed skills support. We feel it's essential there is a face-to-face interaction. It is the difference between a project that succeeds or fails. We believe tech has the power to transform sectors and support the most vulnerable, and we believe Innovation Box is the organisation to drive that step change. We are looking for people to help fund us and to support us. We're interested in reaching across London and across the UK, and we are very interested in talking to anybody who would help us. I stand somewhere lurking over there at the back. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. I'm Alicia, and I'm really grateful for the SSE program because it's helped me to realize one of my dreams, which is to help people who are hungry. I've been affected by the problem of hunger since leaving home in 2002. I was born in South America, but then I moved to Botswana in my teenage years, and I wanted to come to university in England, and so my parents gave me all of their savings and just said, go. And so I attended Surrey University for a little while. Sadly, when I was leaving Botswana, I was given a visa for someone who was a citizen of Botswana, not a resident, and I was a resident. So when I went to the home offices, anyone would, to extend their visa, my passport and my visa were seized. Took the government 9 years to sort it out. 4.5 of those 9 years I spent on the streets, trapped in England for the last 14 years, still haven't been able to see my family, but hey, I'm here feeding hungry people. Being an international student at the University of Surrey, for the short period of time that I was, meant that I had to prioritize money, and food was the sacrifice I had to make to pay for my course, which I eventually dropped off. However, in 2008, somehow I managed to sort of like get my hunger situation together. And I actioned an idea that I had, and that idea was to approach stores for their waste that was fit for human consumption, and I was flooded with food. And so at the time, I attended a local church in Milton Keynes, and I was very involved and started a feeding program, which I'm very proud of. We feed 60 homeless people every Tuesday. They get a free three-course meal. Once a month, we also feed 40 seniors. And in 2014, I wanted to go back to university and sort of finish the degree I started. Now, I had to leave my little baby behind, or so I thought. I remembered when I was at university what I was going through, and so I thought, I'm going to revisit that idea, and realize that because of government cuts and policies and procedures and regulations and so on and so forth that students have to endure, students are still hungry. And so I started Sharing is Caring at the University of Buckingham. Sadly, I've had to drop off my course again because I ran out of money, but I'm not going to stop. I've got 6 months left on my degree, and I am going to finish. Trust me, I will. Okay, so Sharing is Caring basically just give free food to university students as often as, unlike the traditional food bank, which tells them that, you know, after two or three times, don't bother coming. Our scale-up plan is to help with scholarships in the near future, because I have endured not only hunger, but also the shortfall of money and so on and so forth, and also to spread countrywide, because it really is an issue. I am not going to be here after the program, but my details are in the booklet. Please call me. I'm the lovely lady in the red dress. I need your money. Tell your friends who have money. I need your money. We need your money to help to feed hungry students and also to help them to pay for their school fees. Thank you so much.
Me again. I'm still Marie, and my venture started with a book. It's a book I wrote a few years ago. The aim of the book was to offer hope to teenage rape survivors. It follows the story of a girl called Danny Moore. She's a teenage survivor, and every teen fiction novel needs a doofus to fall in love with, and that doofus is her rescue dog called Reggie. The book draws parallels through Danny's diary about how she copes and how her dog helps her. Now, I happen to have a rescue dog looking a lot like that, called Reggie. So the superstar and cover model sends his apologies, but didn't see any biscuits. Now, working with survivors, you're looking at 1 in 3 women and 1 in 6 men who experience sexual violence in this country. Now, I think there has to be an alternative when you look at recovery, potentially something fun, something that offers hope, something a little bit different. Now, when we're working with dogs, especially rescue dogs, you're looking at a means where there's trauma. You have to overcome something. There's resilience there. You're learning to trust humans again. And the process of learning isn't about chastising the behaviors we don't like. It's not about ignoring the stuff we don't like. It's about rewarding and reinforcing the behaviors we do like. We've got a lot to learn from these guys. Now, Canine Perspective is this book coming to life. We draw those parallels and we look at how we can support survivors. Now, when I adopted Reggie, it was around the time, back in, it was about 8-9 years ago, when two Rottweilers killed a child in Leicester. I was told not to get him, dangerous, dangerous, dangerous dog, purely based on his label. He's a Rottie cross. Wrong. Could not be more wrong. When I disclosed my survivor status, I was expected to behave in certain ways, expected to feel certain things, again, because of a label. Wrong again. Now, these projects that we deliver look at those parallels. We work with dogs, we train the dogs, and we look at how we can develop ourselves as a result. Now, over the last year, Canine Perspective has grown beyond belief with thanks to SSE. We have four elements to the business now. We offer training and behaviour, working with dogs and their troubled humans. We have workshops where we go into organisations and look at team building, development, communication, goal setting, all the things we do with dogs. We have a new product line that we're very excited about. And we have our social projects working with survivors, our flagship being Canine Hope. What we're asking of you is just if you're a business, a charity or a social enterprise who likes to do things a little bit differently, get in touch because we might be coming to you for some team building with one of our canine co-tutors. Thank you.
I'm Danielle and I've got around about 12 years experience in community engagement, and my journey with SSE started with a completely different project to the one I'm going to talk to you about today. It was community engagement and it was something that I was really, really proud of, but I quickly learned that my values and the values of my business partner at the time didn't align, and that is something that I didn't then and won't now ever compromise on. So with the support of SSE, and actually, do you know what, the urgency, so it's this, I had this idea bubbling, this project, there's something that I really wanted to do, and I'm here on this programme without a project. So actually, yes, it was the rocket up my bum that I probably needed, but it was also the confidence and the support of my peers and the people that I was working with that meant that I started Art Bar. So Art Bar is a really simple concept. It's a social space to do art. It's basically all it is, and it was born from three factors come together that meant that Art Bar is what it is today. The first was a chance encounter with a young artist. I was looking at her art, and she told me of her story of how if she hadn't have found art, she would have taken her own life. And that was when the penny really dropped for me, how important art can be. So I was my second factor was me in a really fortunate position to go on a trip to Boston and found myself in a sort of a community art kind of group, and I'm painting away with people from all sorts of, I don't even know where they're from in fact, because we didn't speak, we just kind of did art and we just kind of enjoyed each other's company and we drank wine and we just enjoyed being there and doing stuff together. And that was the second moment that I had, that I realized that actually human connection and art just kind of go hand in hand, and this just works. And the third thing that's kind of plagued me for a long time as an adult, and scarily I feel like I have been an adult for longer than I was a child in legal terms, and actually how adults forget how to play. So I'd like kind of just all of you just to take a moment a second and just think about, just take yourself back to a time when you played, when you just let your mind run away, your creativity, and you could just imagine anything, you could be anything, and just take a moment and think about why you stopped doing that, and why you don't just kind of go get your hands dirty and just be in the moment. And that's essentially what Art Bar is about. And brand new, it's a brand new idea. It has been born whilst I've been on the programme, and it's been the people that I've worked with, the courage that I've seen in this group, and the kind of the inspiration from the people that I've been fortunate enough to know, that has meant that Art Bar is in its infancy. And actually my ask today is if anybody has got ideas, I'm just hungry for ideas on what we can do and how we can make Art Bar I have ideas, but I'd love to hear what everybody else has got to say and what about what it can be. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Dave. I'm a web designer and founder of Call of the Brave. It's an ethical crowdfunding service for t-shirt designers. And I'm on a mission. On the 24th of April 2013, 1,134 people lost their lives. They made clothes destined for the UK high street, and it was called the Rana Plaza building disaster. This happened in Bangladesh. The fashion industry uses labour in the poorest countries with the worst health and safety and workers' rights. When this happened, it led me to question my own fashion choices. When I look in my wardrobe, all I see are t-shirts. But I thought maybe there's something I can do with my web design skills and my t-shirt obsession. So, now I hate waste. £140 million worth of clothing ends up in UK landfills every year. And I didn't want to produce t-shirts that weren't as loved and as cherished as my own. So to prove the demand for the shirts, we use crowdfunding. So this is how it works. Luke is a 24-year-old graphic designer. He comes to the Call of the Brave website, uploads an image, sets a time limit, and starts his crowdfunding campaign. He's got that time to get a minimum number of pre-orders, and if he does, then we print and send out the t-shirts. So Luke shares his design or shares his campaign page on social media and emails his friends and asks them to do the same. If Luke hits his target, then we print the t-shirts. So they're printed on shirts where we know that people have been paid a living wage and work in decent conditions. And they're printed on bamboo shirts, which are super soft and more yet hard wearing and sustainable than traditional cotton. For each shirt sold, Luke gets a commission, and we give money to projects in Bangladesh to help people get opportunities away from the sweatshops. So my mission is to empower artists to help people affected by unfair fashion in a way that doesn't cost the earth. And the Call of the Brave is a call to you to be brave, to question your own fashion choices, to value your clothes, and wear the change you want to see in the world. Thank you very much. Come and talk to me afterwards.
We now have with us Karen Williams, the Chief Operating Officer at Dartington Trust. And Karen, if I can ask you just to say a few words. And we then proceed to the kind of certifications and closing speeches.
Hi, everyone. I'm really sorry I wasn't able to be here at the beginning. Train cancellation and all that. So this is one of the highlights of my year. I've been at Dartington for 6 years, and coming to an SSE graduation ceremony is just, well, I'm a bit of a crier. People know me quite well, and I have been welling up because it is just incredible what people can do and what people have done. Dartington is a truly amazing place. Our founders, Dorothy and Leonard Elmhurst, wanted to create something very special. They thought the world was broken, and they thought they could do something in rural Devon to help deal with rural deprivation, but also think of enterprise in a different way. And I think the links to what you guys are doing today and what you've learned and what the journey you've been on is similar to kind of what Dorothy and Leonard did, because what they wanted to do was enterprise that had purpose, that meant something. So it wasn't just out for profit's sake, it was to say actually we could do something different in the world, we can give people work, meaning in life, and we can make that work in a way that they have a living and they can pay for that. So I don't want to take away from what have done today, but I'd just like to say that I think that Dorothy and Leonard and the legacy that we are trying to push forward into this new world, which probably feels just as broken as it did in the 30s when they came to Devon. You are such a part of that. I'll get well up again. So thank you so much. And I hope you carry on with your enterprises, and I hope they carry on growing and being something quite special in your world and the communities that you're involved with. So thank you for sharing it today.
Okay, we're coming to the kind of time in the afternoon where we're going to celebrate these new entrepreneurs and send them on their way. But before that, it's with great pleasure that I have the honour to introduce to you the Mayor of Bristol, Marvin Rees, who's going to join us and say a few words to the students. It is due to the generosity of Bristol City Council that we're here. They've given us a home for the last year down in South Bristol in the Filbert Green Business Park. And together with South Gloucestershire and Baines Councils, they have been the match funders for this programme. And without them, it wouldn't have been possible to do this. So it's really with gratitude and with great pleasure to introduce you.
So thanks very much, and it's great to see you all here. I bounce around a number of meetings during the day. I've just come with from my cabinet member, Asher, here, just from my cabinet. But I'm just looking over about the scale of the contribution made to the city by the school. I've got here 406 volunteer positions have been created by the social ventures supported by the Bristol programme. Bristol students and fellows have generated £1.16 million in turnover in the last year. 78 social entrepreneurs have been supported by the Bristol Lloyds programme since 2012. 26 business experts have contributed. 146 full and part-time jobs have been created by the Bristol fellows. 20 social entrepreneurs and witnesses have shared their journey with our cohorts in Bristol. But 146 jobs, 406 volunteer opportunities. This is a real contribution to the city. This is something of real substance, and I thank you for making that. If I put this in a context of the moment as well, if you've been watching the news over the last week, you'll see that we face some financial challenges in local government. It's £33 million in savings this financial year, and we're in year. and £92 million between 2017 and 2022, which is a massive challenge. The result of a shrinking settlement from central government combined with a growing population with increasing demand on our services. And the fact is that local government cannot be what it was 10 years ago. And I think one of those things is that we're going to have to look at running places in a new way. One of the things we've been talking about amongst the political leadership and some of our key city partners is how we're much more proactive in becoming an enabling organisation. And this gathering in many ways speaks to the heart of that. We will not be able to go around providing, in the first instance, there'll be the first port of call for social provision, for public interventions, whatever it is. We're going to have to be an organisation that enables our partners and enables partners that we don't yet know about who will come up and to begin delivering. But I think that shouldn't be a scary prospect. My arguments with central government, or discussions I should say, and with our partners is it's not a case of we're not arguing for big government or small government. We're arguing for a government that has resources to get done what it needs to get done. But what it also needs to get done is not to be the port of first call, but enabling people in our communities to get stuff done within our communities, which is where social enterprises become so absolutely critical. I wrote a piece for Thrive magazine just recently, which is Vosca's magazine, and I wrote a piece about the voluntary community sector and the social enterprise sector as well, and I made a number of points in that piece. One was that as a city, it's really important that we begin to take into account the full value of social enterprise and voluntary sector in a city. And that value is not just by adding up the value of the services that are provided. That is taking into full account what it means to see finance that is connected to social outcomes and what that means to the culture of a place. The volunteer opportunities that I've just read out that are created, that sense of local ownership as well. All of this is worth money. Very, very hard to measure, but we do know that if we don't have local ownership, if we don't have coherent communities that are built around that sense of local ownership, of coherence, of that local pride, we have to spend money on the kind of social interventions to make up for those social failings. So as a city, we want to take a more mature understanding of the value of social enterprise. The second is what I was just saying. I think that it's really important to look at the nature of the relationship between people and local government as well. A lot of African American writers coming out of the civil rights movement were writing that actually the increasing presence of government services, and I'm going to get tweeted the wrong way on this, that make me sound like I'm a Blairite invading, you know, the current tone of the discussion sometimes. But there can be a dependency culture that is created. And maybe in this moment of crisis, there's an opportunity to say, how do you create space for people to build their own enterprises and their own businesses and their own ventures, not in the name of ravenously pursuing returns for shareholders, but in the names of starting up enterprises in a way that actually benefits society, doing business in a new way. And we have a reputation of this in Bristol, and it's a reputation I'd love to foster. There's something very rich, I think, in thinking about people not even needing public services in that sense. And I had a conversation the other day where I said, we're not trying to create a public service culture, but we're actually people are generating those interventions within their own communities with the enabling support of local government to do that as well. And that meets that challenge that we have around our financial situation as well, because we simply won't be able to do everything. So I hope that as you go through this afternoon, you think about the full value of what you do, but also begin to think strategically about how this whole sector can play a part in shaping the kind of city we not only have to be, but I think also maybe want to be going into the future. So your broader thoughts on that would be very welcome as we think that through and plan it out. So thank you for what you've done.
Thank you very much, Mayor. We're kind of
Marvin's fine.
Maria Vieni.
Well, we're almost ready for our refreshments, which I believe are behind the screens at the back there, and for the exhibition and the networking. It just remains for me to say a few thank yous. So I've mentioned Bristol City Council, South Gloucestershire Council, and Bath and North East Somerset Council, who have been our local funders for this programme. But this programme has been nationally funded by Lloyds Bank and Big Lottery, so I want to say a very big thank you to them. This is a 5-year programme. There's one more year to come from their funding. And also particularly to the Lloyds mentors. So as some of the students have talked about, every student had a mentor from Lloyds Bank. Some of those might be here in the audience actually today. And on the whole, it's been really a wonderful experience. It doesn't always work out, but on the whole, it's a very good experience. And of course, we're grateful for the kind of colleagues from Lloyds Bank to give their time and energy to the students. So these are kind of the thank yous to the big funders. I also want to thank all the contributors and supporters and presenters on the programme, the facilitators, and last but not least, our team. And I've got a few things. So, Pete. Where's Pete? Pete! Wonderful how Pete stepped into this role and took on the group, and this is the first time that everybody who started on the programme also finished the programme. So this is a real kind of compliment to the rest of the group. And now none of this would have worked without our fantastic Sam. Just a little story I must tell about Sam. So Sam joined us, what's about 5 years ago?
6 years ago.
6 years ago. And Sam had been running a social enterprise with her mum and felt, you know, it's time to do something a bit more, I suppose, conventional.
Yes.
Take a job. And she started us working in admin and coordination. And actually, Sam is a wonderful person, kind of turned her hand to so many talents. And she's now become our learning manager, our lead learning manager, and Sam actually runs the Plymouth program, which is a sister program to this program here. So well done, Sam. Great to see you. I also want to say a special thank you to Lucy.
Yeah, she's up.
Where's Lucy?
I think she's up.
Well, she's been out there other days. Lucy stepped in, what about just 2 months ago,
yes,
at very last notice, because we were one person down, and really pulled all this together for this graduation ceremony here, all the logistics. So great thank you to Lucy and to Joe, who's here, also part of our team. Without this team, we just couldn't do this. So I'm really kind of grateful for you and the work you're doing to put this all together and to help the students to become the kind of aspiring entrepreneurs. So with that, I'm really happy to send you on your way. I know you're going to make a difference to your life.
I just need to say as well, interrupting that we need to thank you.
Part of a European funded programme? Yes, there is such a thing. If we get it through, I think, before the autumn statement, then we will be funded to do this for another 3 years, together with partners here in the city and across the west of England. So we're very kind of excited about that. We're very anxious. And hopefully by the end of November, it will all be signed and we will be ready to go for the next 3 years. So with that, you've been sitting long enough. There's plenty of refreshments out there. Use the time to kind of make contacts, talk to the entrepreneurs, see their wonderful exhibition they've set up. Enjoy yourself and have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you.